the Serenity Prayer. And all these years, I've been reciting the Serenity Prayer. It's not until I prepared this message that I discovered that this is only a portion of the prayer. Amen. It's a very powerful prayer, and you would have it in your hand if I would have gotten my computer to communicate with my printer in my office. Somehow it was knocked offline, and I was back there trying to get the printer to come up. But I'll print it out and give it to you, and I'll just recite it today in the context of the message. The Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity, the calmness, the steadiness. The calmness, the steadiness. Because there are things in this life that shake us. I was sitting here just while Pastor Dan was praying, and the thought occurred to me that there are things that have shook me in this life, but God's love was bigger than those things.
Yes. Amen.
So even though I am acutely aware that they floored me on the outside, I didn't get knocked down the floor because God was holding me up, even though on the inside they floored me. Amen?
Amen.
God, grant me the serenity, the calmness, the steadiness to accept the things I cannot change. To come to the conclusion I am not in control of anyone or anything. Help me. Help me, Lord. Because it's a lot of things we want to change. Right? And oftentimes it's not with us, it's with other people and other things. Amen.
Yes.
But we really only have time and space and energy to focus on us. And
just
perhaps, if something transformative happened in us, it might have an impact on changing others around us. Right. Just perhaps. To accept the things I cannot change, courage. Sometimes you need courage to confront life, to confront situations and circumstances, to confront sin, to confront injustices. Sometimes you need courage to stand up for Jesus, to really be a Christian. You need courage. Courage to change the things I can, the impact I can make, to not be impotent, but to be potent by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. Sometimes your church looks impotent because it sounds quiet. It sounds like it has nothing to say. It appears that it has no impact. So it appears to be impotent. But I believe it's somehow related to people not having the courage to fully live out our faith. Courage to change the things that I can't. Wisdom to know the difference. It's some stuff that we need to leave alone. Some things we just meddle. Some things we say have no redeeming value. Some things we do, they're not for the kingdom. So we need the wisdom to know the difference. There are things in this life that will derail us, and it's not just because of It can be because life happens. Life happens. Things happen in life. People make decisions in life. Since September of 2005, my wife has been in excruciating pain unrelated to fibromyalgia. My daughter was driving down Southfield Freeway with her permit. The traffic comes to a stop, a complete stop. And a Ford Explorer slams into the back of our car, totals it out. Robert is sitting in the back. Everything shatters in the back. Glass is all in his throat. Thank God he didn't get squashed. Dogs in the car, they don't get hurt. But my wife injures her neck and her L4, L5. And it just totally disrupts her sciatic nerve. Totally disconnected. Life happens. The person said they could not find the brake.
They should have been driving.
Now, I don't know. I can speculate that you can't find the brake if you're texting.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm speculating. I don't know. But they couldn't find the brake. My daughter has not driven since, and my wife has been in pain ever since. Life happens. Life happens. Here's the reality. Nowhere in the Bible are we told the Christian life is going to be easy. Nowhere in the Bible. In fact, the opposite is true. The Bible tells us that life will be full of trouble. The Bible tells us that we're born in sin, shaped in iniquity. The Bible tells us that we'll have trials and tribulations. So, it's opposite. John 16:33 tells us, I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. But here on earth you will have many trials and sorrow. Your heart will be broken. Things will stir you to tears. You will become emotionally distraught over some things. Whether you're a believer or not. But he's talking to the believer. And some of these things have the potential to derail us. For us to give up. Remember, we're talking about living forward, but there are some things in this life will cause us to turn and run, or cause us to step off the journey, or cause us to freeze, just become incapacitated. I can't move forward, I can't move backwards, I'm numb, I can't move. Things happen in this life to all of us. No one is immune to life happening. All you have to do is live in life coming. It's coming.
Yep.
I was talking to my daughter yesterday about what ifs. And I said, Mel, you don't want to live your life based upon what ifs. You want to have some sense of purpose and destiny and live your life based upon that, and what ifs are going to happen. Whether you want them to or not. So you don't have to figure out what ifs. Because what ifs are coming. What you need to focus on is how you're going to live your life. Where's your life going? Who are you looking to guide your life? And who are you living for? What is your standard of living? And even in the midst of that, if you use all of your faculty, all of your mind and emotions, your heart, your body, your soul, if you point everything in one direction and you strain with all your might to move in that direction, and life is still going to happen. There will still be things that have the potential to derail you. So all a Christian can hope for is what Paul said in 2 Timothy 4:7. You want to be able to come to the end of life. You want to be able to come to the end of life and say, I fought a good fight.
Uh-huh.
You want to be able to say, I fought. I didn't pump out. I didn't wimp out. I fought. Every day I woke up and I fought. Sometime I won. But I got up the next day and fought even on the days I lost. I still got up the next day and I fought and I fought and I fought. And sometimes Satan sucker punched me, but I still fought. But sometimes my flesh was stronger than me, but I still got up every day and I fought and I fought and I fought a good fight.
Amen.
Yep, yep, yep.
You want to be able to say that without reservation, that I fought a good fight. You want to be able to say that I finished my race. So first of all, I need to understand my race. I need to know what my race is, not what your race is. I need to know what my race is. What does God have for me to do? What is it God has for me to do? See, because if God's plan for my life is for me to be a Cub Scout leader and to minister to Cub Scouts until Jesus come back, then that's what I need to be about. I need to be about what God has for me to do. If God just wants me to focus on my family and just be a good husband and a good father and forget about any type of leadership role and in the public sector, then that's what I need to do. I need to be focused on what God has for me to do. If God tells you, this is what I want you to do. I just want you to come on Riverview, and I just want you to spend time with neighbors on Riverview. Don't worry about being in no position in that little church you go to. I just want you Monday through Friday, I want you to come on Riverview, and I want you to minister on Riverview. Then that's my race. Might not be your race. Might not be Pastor Carter race. That would be my race. So we have to be able to say at the end that I fought a good fight, that I fought every day, and that I have finished my race. My race. Now you need to understand your race is between you and God. Sometimes people will try to give you a race. It's like we were out at Roper. Our boys' basketball team was playing against Roper, and at first quarter it was 14-17. They was up by three. And then our coach just unleashed. They went into a four-court press, and they won like 74-24 or something. And the AD comes to me and say, Mr. Wills, y'all need to have a track team. Because you have gazelles in here. I say, that's a thought. But right now, I'm trying to pay payroll. I didn't tell him that. I don't need another expense. I need to run my race. I need to understand the purpose of my educational institution. I don't have people paying $25,000 a year to go to school. I have people paying $1,000 a year to go to school. So you can have everything out there in Birmingham. But if I get caught up in his race, I might try to have all the bells and whistles they have. We see it in churches all the time. I was talking to a sister the other day. We were grieving over the death of Mount Olive. 80-something-year-old church on Wilford. Beautiful edifice. Pastor Newby pastored so many years. When he retired, he left the church debt-free. Debt-free. Pastor come behind him and want to remodel the church and can't pay the loan, and the church is closed.
Oh, wow.
Church is closed. 80-something-year-old church is no longer open because you're trying to be like other people or run other folk race. Run your race. See, because if you don't understand your race, then and you get caught up in running a race that is not yours, then your life can become derailed. He derailed. He killed that church. Killed it. Trying to be like everyone else. You didn't need new light fixtures to minister to people. Just ask great commission. No. All you need is the lights to come on.
Right.
Hello, somebody. So fight the good fight. Finish the race. And then watch what Paul says with conviction. He says, I've remained faithful.
Amen.
I haven't wavered. You didn't say I've been perfect. Is he the same brother said, I sought the Lord thrice for this infirmity, for this thing to be taken from me. So he didn't have this life that was pristine and he walking around like a super Christian. He even, this same guy said, I'm the chief sinner. So he had a healthy self-concept in terms of God, but he also clearly understood his mission in life, and he didn't deviate from it, so he could say with confidence, I fought a good fight. I ran my race. And I was thankful. That's all God asked for. He ain't asked you to do some great thing. The great thing is, be faithful. Whatever he tell you to do, do it.
Amen.
Do it to the best of your ability. When you fall short, repent and get up and keep on doing it.
Amen.
Be faithful. Be faithful. In Hebrews chapter 3, the Bible gives us three quick points that help us not be derailed. As we live forward, we're trying to not be derailed from this Christian journey. Stuff will trip us up, y'all. But we try not to be tripped up. 3 points. First point is consider the saints. Consider the saints. Second point, consider yourself. Consider the saints. Consider yourself. And then consider your Savior. Consider the saints. Consider yourself. And consider the Savior. First of all, when we look at the saints, in chapter 11, we see what is commonly called the annals of faith, the heroes of faith. We list these people like they are spiritual giants. That's how we mention them, like they're spiritual giants. But in reality, they're just ordinary people. That's all they are. They ordinary people like you and I. It's even listed in James chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. It says, Elijah was a human as we are. Yet he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, and none fell there for 3.5 years. Then he prayed again, and the sky sent down rain, and the earth began to yield his crop. So we look at him and like he's some spiritual giant just because he was faithful to God, and God used him and through him did something miraculous that defied science. But here's the thing. The Bible said first, even before it mentioned it, he was just a man.
Uh-huh.
That's all he is. That's why I tell you, don't, I can't get with that whole, that pedestal approach to pastoring. I'm a man trying to get to heaven like you, a man or woman trying to get to heaven.
Yeah.
So don't set me up to fail. Don't put me on no pedestal where I gotta fall down and then you dog me when I fall. No, just leave me right with you on the ground. Leave me in the struggle. Just like you in the struggle, I'm in the struggle. I'm trying to live out my faith just like you trying to live out your faith. All those men and women of the Bible who God used, all they did is run their race. That was their purpose for their existence. We need to be about the business of running ours. That's it. Run your race. So these people had a race to run, and they were nothing but mere common men and women. Consider the saints. Consider the folk we hold up in high esteem. They wasn't part angel and part human. They was just human beings. Like you and I. So if they can trust God, we can trust God.
Amen.
Live forward. You can live forward. Secondly, when we look at the saints, what we see is not just their faithfulness, but what's revealed here is that God is reliable. God was reliable. When we look at the annals of faith and all that those men and women went through and how God used them, the story that's told is less about them and more about God. That God is faithful. We can count on him. If he said it, he'll do it. He's not a man that he should lie, nor is he the son of man that he would have to repent. His word would go out, it would not return void. It accomplished that which he sent it out to accomplish. And what it accomplishes will please him. It ain't about us. It's always about him. And he's faithful. God is faithful. He sustained them. He protected them. He hid them. He fought for them. He made their word sure. If they said something, he made sure it came to pass. Because they were striving to do God's will. They didn't have no special market on Christianity or a special market on a relationship with God. It was just the fact that they were striving to be faithful to the living God. And as a result of that, they were in the will of God. And as a result of that, God could bring his full power, his full presence to bear on their life.
Amen.
History could happen. Life could happen. But you think some of them were never discouraged? Ask Elijah. Ask Abraham why he lied about his wife being his sister. When really she was his sister. Because they were from the same father but two different mamas. Baby mama drama. So he was like, you fine. You go up in here, they ain't going to want to do nothing against the laws. So they ain't going to mess with you. They're going to have to kill me first to get at you. So tell them you my sister. This is Abraham, the father of faith, the one who Jesus, who God said, through you will be as many people, members of the annals of faith, as many as the sand on the seashore.
Yeah.
We still call Abraham the father of faith. He didn't have a whole bunch of faith that day. And in some days we don't, amen?
Amen.
But then again, let me talk about myself, because you know, I understand we might have super Christians among us. So, but for me, I'm like Abraham some days. Some days I'm like Abraham, who went up on the mountain and took the knife and took his son and laid him on the altar. But listen now, even before he did that, he told his servants, we will be back.
Amen.
Don't miss that point.
Yeah.
So he was going through the process, but he had faith that God had told him through Isaac some stuff was going to happen. So I don't know how God going to fix this thing, but it's going to work out. Come on, Isaac. I have to slice you up, bro. But he told his servants, we'll be back. So sometimes I have faith like that. Like you said it, God. I'm down with it. But sometimes it's like,
I don't know.
Tell them you my sister. Because I don't know how this thing gonna go down. But that's the ebb and flow of life, the ebb and flow of the Christian journey, the ebb and flow of being wrapped in flesh, of being humanity. That's why we have to look at Paul's words in context. He didn't have anything different than what we have. But yet he got up every day and fought. He got up every day and ran just his race. No one else's, his race. He got up every day and he was faithful to what God said to him. That's it. That's it. So consider the saints, consider that they're mere humans, and consider that God was reliable throughout their lives.
Yeah.
And remember. And don't talk yourself out of stuff. See, because something happened in our life, and we'll talk ourselves out of the race. We'll tell ourselves, oh, I need to stop running to deal with this. No, this thing you're dealing with is part of the race. It's part of the journey.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about what we did with Pastor Carter and said, no, we're going to suspend Bible study for a while. Because he's still in the race. Brother sat in front of the sanctuary and taught Sunday school this morning. I'm talking about folk that disappear from the journey. Just get off the journey. For whatever reason. Whether it's death in your family or overworked or problems in your home. And problems in your home disqualified you. I should have packed up and got ghosts a long time ago. Why you been sick 8 years? And that's just her. I ain't even gonna go into my children. They not here to defend themselves. So if I was only looking at life circumstances to determine whether I'm qualified to do what God has called me to do, I'm hit. But I'm only qualified because God qualifies me. And when he qualified me, he knew everything that would occur. Matter of fact, he knew me. My strengths, my weaknesses, my shortcomings. Just like he knew Abraham. Just like he knew Elijah. Elijah took off running. That great victory. And then he let that woman scare him. Killed all them prophets. Heard help me out. Not Jezebel. Jezebel, that boy got word that Jezebel was on his head and he took off running. Like, brother, how can you experience this great victory of God and then punk out over Jezebel? Because he's human. Because life happens. Because it's reality.
Yeah.
That's how. So we have to be careful not even to judge people. Hello? Because we don't know the journey. Secondly, we have to look at ourselves. We have to look at ourselves. We must make proper preparation. The Bible tells us to lay all weight aside. To lay all weight aside. This refers to a runner making sure that all